Hello and welcome to Better Geology. I'm Andrew Dunning, and I have finally opened up a soil test pit on the Strawberry Fault. So this video is documenting the process of digging a paleoseismic trench on the Strawberry Fault. This is really an extension of the project I did for my master's thesis. The basic premise of the project originally was just to get an overview of the Strawberry Fault. How does it behave over time? What sort of features does it cross? You know, how does it relate to the local geology? But over time, we realized that this was actually a much more significant fault structure than we first thought, which is saying something because we already knew that it was a remarkable feature that had really no data on it at the time. So digging the trench really grew out of that. At the end of my first field season, I spent a week doing auger core transects across a short section of the Strawberry Fault, where the fault faces uphill in such a way that sediment is ponded against the fault plane. And that sediment ponding actually records earthquake events over time. So we did auger transects across that to get an understanding of how many earthquakes may be represented in the features we see on the surface, what kinds of sediments do we find along the fault. And after I finished that portion of the study, it became apparent that we really needed to do a paleoseismic trench. And we dig a paleoseismic trench to get a definite record of how many earthquakes reach the surface and can be damaging to life and property, etc. I got special permission from the Forest Service to dig this short trench. Really, it's more of a test pit just outside of the Strawberry Wilderness, right across the fault. So we get a really clear picture of the earthquake history and the deformation history of the Strawberry Fault in most recent geologic time. So the first part of the study did conclusively show that the Strawberry Fault is active across long spans of geologic time. The data we collected from cosmogenic exposure dating showed that the glacial deposits that the Strawberry Fault crosses and cuts and offsets vertically are up to over 100,000 years old. So that's not two, not three, but four ice ages ago, the Strawberry Mountains were covered in large glaciers that left deposits that the Strawberry Fault crosses and cuts. The most recent glacial maxima was about 23,000 years ago in the Strawberry Mountains, and the Strawberry Fault offsets those deposits from about 1 to 3 meters generally, and based on what we call scaling relationships. These are the relationships between how big a given fault is and the types of earthquakes it produces and what are the characteristics of those earthquakes and faults. That amount of offset shows probably 2 earthquakes over this amount of time, this size of an earthquake over the 28 or so kilometers of the fault length. So because the Strawberry Fault is about 28 kilometers long, we expect the average earthquake to maybe produce 1.5 on average meters of vertical separation at the surface per earthquake. Now, because those youngest glacial deposits are 23,000 years old and they're offset no more than 3 meters, we can safely say, okay, so probably 2 earthquakes are represented in most of these surface scarps, these fault features. And that gives us a great place to start with for this soil trench. So the 2 earthquakes in the last 23,000 year period gives us a good guesstimate for the earthquake history analyses. The primary deposits at the trench site are glacial in origin. It's what's called glacial till. So the big glacier comes down off the summit of Strawberry Mountain, and it leaves all this stuff behind. Mostly sort of a sandy silt texture with these large boulders and smaller angular rocks sort of strewn throughout it. And when we dug the trench, we came down right on top of one of these big boulders that happened to be sat right on top of the fault plane. So what that did was it made digging the trench very difficult. And it also made the stratigraphy really complicated and difficult to analyze, because that rock doesn't deform in an earthquake, but the soil around it does. So you end up with the sort of generally uniform soil layers that were sitting on top of the rock get fractured and split apart during the earthquake instead of being nicely, neatly cut or folded and deformed. So when we began analyzing this trench, we started by counting the soil layers. These are different distinctive units, packages of sediment and soil that are around the fault. Every time there's an earthquake, these soil units are disturbed in some way. Some of them are broken apart, some of them are offset directly some of them are folded. And the ultimate goal is to understand which of these soil units was disturbed by the fault at what point in time. So your oldest layers are going to be disturbed the most. They will have experienced the most earthquakes over time. So in the trench, the lowest unit saw probably 2 earthquakes. Now from every one of these soil units, we recover charcoal. Some pieces of which are quite large, like this one I have right here. Pieces of charcoal like this one can be carbon dated. So when you get enough charcoal samples from a given soil layer and send those to be carbon dated, you get an average age, or at least an understanding of the age range of a given soil unit. So if we know a soil unit of this certain age is offset or disturbed by the fault this amount, but this younger unit, which is younger because it's higher in the soil column or because the carbon dating tells us it's younger, is disturbed less, that means it's seen fewer earthquakes. From this trench, we collected dozens and dozens and dozens of individual charcoal samples from all throughout the soil column, all throughout the trench, all different environments. We ended up only having enough funding to submit 10. So with those 10 charcoal samples, in addition to the auger core analysis I did the year prior, we were able to actually get a pretty thorough picture of the earthquake history of this particular locality on the Strawberry Fault. The carbon 14 data for these soil units gave us really high precision age data for the most recent earthquake. The most recent earthquake on the Strawberry Fault, according to the stratigraphy and all of the evidence we gathered from this trench, occurred sometime between 652 and 875 Common Era, or AD. That's a pretty tight age range for having as little data as we were able to have. And I'm very satisfied, and the rest of our collaborators are very satisfied with that data we've collected. And that is currently being peer-reviewed and will eventually be published in a major scientific journal, which I'm quite proud of. So we got that very satisfying high-precision age for the most recent earthquake. But the second to most recent earthquake, which we call the penultimate earthquake, we weren't really able to get a good narrow age range for that. And that was because the lowermost soil unit was really poor in charcoal. There just wasn't a lot of it to be found near the base of that unit. And what that meant was I wasn't able to submit as many samples for that. So the best we can say is that it was sometime between about 8,000 years ago and the last glacial advance about 23,000 years ago. So that's a much less satisfying precision for that age, but we take what we can get in field work. Let's walk through the different soil units we find in the trench. The lowermost unit is that glacial till, that sandy, really blocky, messy soil unit that's made of mostly silty sand, boulders, and rocks, and is generally hard to dig through. On top of that is a soil developed on that, which also includes material raveled off of the upthrown side of the fault, and also material that just flows in from uphill into this small enclosed basin. We called the next one Unit B. Unit B is made of that ponded sediment which filled up against the scarp, both from material that fell off of the collapsing scarp over time and material that washed down from the slopes higher above, filling up this enclosed basin. It's very fine-grained, very dark, and rich in organics, and it is overlain directly by a 10 to 20 centimeter thick layer of mesama ash. The mesama ash is a layer of volcanic ash, or ejecta, that resulted from the eruption of Mount Mesama that caused the collapse of the volcano and gave us Crater Lake. That ash layer has a very well-established age, so that was another great marker for understanding the earthquake history, because it was only offset by the most recent earthquake. So before doing any carbon 14 dating, we already knew that the most recent earthquake was younger than that mesama ash, so it was younger than about 7,000 years old. On top of the mesama ash layer, this very thick, well-consolidated ash layer, was a really light and fluffy, sort of a light brown layer that was made up mostly of inclusions of that mesama ash that had been reworked into this really light, fluffy soil. In my notes, I just called it light and fluffy unit. This didn't contain any kinds of rocks or large debris of any kind, so that suggested that it was laid down and developed at a time when there were no earthquakes. Because if there were large earthquakes, we would have found rocks in it close to the fault like we were. So because that unit didn't have any rocks in it, we were quite confident in saying that it was also older than the most recent earthquake. The soil unit above that, Unit E, does contain some small rocks. So the base of the unit that contains rocks and the top of the unit that has no rocks is what we call the event horizon. It was at that point in time that the most recent earthquake happened. So we took many, many charcoal samples to be carbon dated from just above that line and just below that line. And those are the samples that we used to establish the age of the most recent earthquake, which occurred between 652 and 875 CE, or AD. This was a time in history when the Byzantine Empire was all the rage and catapults were a favorite new invention. After the trench was done being excavated, the next task was to clean the walls, scrape them clean. The reason we have to clean the walls is to get all the dust off to make sure we can see all of the different soil structures and maybe fault features, get as clear of a picture as possible of what the subsurface looks like, adjacent and away from the fault. Cleaning the walls and establishing a reference grid are critically important to allowing us to understand the features of the soil units, any features left behind by the fault. Basically just get as clear of a picture as possible of the subsurface, both next to the fault and away from the fault. The reference grid gives us coordinates to reference things from, whether that's the position of a fault feature or the location of some of those large charcoal samples that we use. Recording the positions of features is a very important part of documenting the trench, because once you fill it in after the project's over, all you have to remember it by are pictures and your notes. So keeping detailed location notes for everything you see is very important to creating a good interpretation of your trench when you're done. So between cleaning the walls of the trench, establishing the reference grid, taking pictures for a orthophoto mosaic and 3D model, we then left the trench open for a month. After many scheduling conflicts and other things that get in the way of doing hard science, our trench sat there in the mountains, exposed to the elements. So when we came back a month later, we then had to begin the whole process over again. Cleaning the walls for a couple of days, re-photographing all of the walls and creating a 3D model, and then we got to finish analyzing the trench, take all the charcoal samples, and then fill it in. We did all of that in 3 days, and drove back to Portland on the same day we filled the trench in. That was about a 20-hour work day. So because of that, in total, we were on site at the trench only about a week, which is really short, really fast, and a lot shorter than other types of these investigations I've been a part of. That doesn't mean the quality of the work is any less, because the trench was so small, and really we got all we could out of it in that time. The high level of detail I recorded everything in when we were there made it so that I was still able to reinterpret and understand all of my data all through the last year and a half, and now it's on its way to being published in a major journal. So what does all this mean in the context of geology research in the Northwest? Well, above all, we just don't have very much data for crustal earthquakes like the Strawberry Fault can produce in eastern Oregon. The rugged topography, the general remoteness of the area makes it very hard to collect good high-quality data on youthful earthquake features and the things they produce on the landscape. So primarily this research contributes to a general understanding of earthquake hazard in the Northwest and how the upper crust of the earth deforms in that area. It's very complex, and really the next step for this research is to see what the scientific community says about it. I'm really excited to see where the feedback from the scientific community guides the future of research in the Strawberry Mountains. And now, just for fun, here's the outro I shot in the field, in the trench, right as the thunderstorm rolled in. So this soil test pit is the first in-depth study of the Strawberry Fault. This is actually the first time anybody has ever laid eyes on the Strawberry Fault plain itself, along which earthquakes happen seemingly every 10,000 years. Based on data I got last year, we think the most recent earthquake was somewhere between about the year 250 and the year 1700. So that's a big margin of error, and that's why we came back to dig this big pit and narrow down that margin of error a little bit. We're gonna figure out how old each soil unit is using carbon dating of naturally occurring charcoal from ancient prehistoric forest fires, and by bracketing the age of each soil unit and measuring how it's deformed, we can determine when the earthquake happened as it correlates with the soil units. And that's a very interesting and lengthy and expensive process, which is why it's important to do as much as we can right here, even though there's an incoming thunderstorm and it's starting to get a little hairy and we should get out of here soon. This has been Better Geology. I'm Andrew Dunning. Thank you very much for watching. And there's the thunder. Okay, time to go.